Welcome to the only place where real, raw, and vulnerable conversations happen with IFBB bikini pros to give you an inside look at their struggles, strategies, mindset, passions, and all of life beyond the stage. This podcast is made to inspire, motivate, and remind competitors and the average gym goer that even the most extreme lifestyles and elite athletes have their ups and downs. Thank you so much for tuning in today. I'm your host, Celeste Rains-Turk, and now it's time for the Confessions of a Bikini Pro podcast. Today, I will be interviewing a mathematician, health coach, board member, finance chair, and inspirational speaker with 18 years in the investment banking industry and prior CEO of the Association for Women in Science. She became an IFBB bikini pro at her third national show, placing first in her classes. This woman was inspired to make progress in her career, live a healthy lifestyle, and take care of herself after losing her mom to breast cancer. And after working for World Bank, closing multi-billion dollar deals, and making strides in her healthy lifestyle, she herself found herself with a lump in her breast, which went away after prioritizing her vitality, confidence, and health to a whole new level. After this experience, she found passion for helping others to build wealth in their portfolios, personal brand, and health, and she was even named one of the 100 most influential people of African descent under 40 by the United Nations. And it has been 6 years since she left corporate America, launched her business, Fit Hidden Figure, and I got to meet her this January, actually only a few months ago. It feels like forever ago now, but I really, really was impressed by this woman. And obviously, I didn't even know all of that when I met her. So that just adds to the impressiveness. So welcome to the show, Karene Richards-Wise. How are you doing?
I am doing well. Celeste, can I tell you that I've always wanted to be on your show? Wanted to be here. I have learned so much from the work that you've been doing, getting experiences from other bikini competitors. And I have leveraged it in my competitive journey. So this is a dream come true to be here at this moment. I am super excited to do this, and I'm willing to pay it forward and put what you have put in me and pay it forward to other bikini athletes coming up in the sport.
That's so awesome. Like, hearing that makes me super happy because I want this podcast to be like that. It's fostering community. It's fostering relationships. It's also giving people hope and insight and information. So it makes me happy that that's how you feel. So, I have to ask you if you have a ritual you do right before your heel hits the stage.
Yes, I do. I am a Christian. I say the Lord's Prayer. And then I said, God, it's just you and I, and then we hit the stage. When you write on the stage, it's only you and God at that point. And he influenced my every facial expression, my every move. And that's what I think about just before hitting the stage.
That's beautiful. I love that you see it as a great opportunity to connect with him, because I've met a lot of women of faith who sometimes judge themselves or have been judged for pursuing this sport and being a woman of God. They feel like they can't do both. So did you ever face that or experience those concerns or judgment?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Absolutely. But I have since overcome that. Interestingly, I was part of a discipleship program called Sisters in Discipleship, and it is an invitation-only ministry in my church, right? Mm-hmm. The people that come out of this program end up being deaconesses of the church. So the director of the program met me and decided that she wanted to do a transformation, right? So I said, deaconess, it means I have to take a before and after picture of you now. And she goes, okay, but I don't want anyone to see, she's in a sports bra and leggings. But when her transformation was done, she goes, oh my gosh, the world has to see this because it is so inspiring. And so even hearing it from someone as senior as her, it was just moving for me to be able to pour so much into me spiritually. for me to pour this into her and for her to see her body so differently and see that she can use her body to actually inspire others. Her daughter even said, I cannot have my mom looking better than me. I don't know what the heck is going on. Her grandchildren was saying that, Grandma, you're reversing in age, you know, when they see the pictures. So she proudly shares her pictures now, you know, and it has been really warm for me to experience that. But yes, I did get the judgment. I lost friends when I got into fitness, you know, the churchy type. They thought I was just too out there, too wild. And that's okay. You know, I kept pushing my dreams. I know I'm living a healthy and fit lifestyle that's going to cause me to live longer. So, you know, it was tough in the beginning. I dealt with a lot of insecurities. Where that is concerned. The other piece too is that I serve on a few boards and, you know, I post my fitness journey on LinkedIn and I was told, hey, you know, boards may not consider you if you're on LinkedIn in a bikini, you know.
Yeah.
So I've experienced that too, but overcame that and still get board positions. You know, and share both sides of my life, you know. So, yeah, it comes from church, it comes from business, you know, you name it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's important to just stay true to what you want to do and what feels right for you. And by the way, before we get into more conversation, if you're listening to this podcast, know that there's also a video. We're recording this on video too. So if you go to YouTube, celestial_fit, you'll see the video here as well. And we're wearing a matching outfit, which is super cute from Cuties Conquering the Stage. But definitely, like, if you are listening and you want to watch this episode, know that that is available. I forgot to mention that earlier, wanted to say that now. And Karene, you know, you just brought up LinkedIn and you brought up the impact of how people saw you in the professional world as well. And you do a lot of actually business marketing on LinkedIn. And I think it's a great place to grow a business, especially a fitness coaching business. If you want to work with professionals or you want to inspire them or you're one yourself, you've had many of your own transformations within that world. So before we maybe go into some of your journey, there's a lot of people who listen who are also building a business. So how have you utilized LinkedIn and your professional space to develop your business?
That's a great question. So remember, I have 18 years experience in investment banking. And during those 18 years, I was diligent with connecting with folks on LinkedIn every time I met, every time I went to a conference, if I saw a speaker, I will connect with them. So I built up about 5,000 followers in LinkedIn. And then when I started the business, I decided to go on the back end of LinkedIn, the Sales Navigator. There's a system called Connected, where you can go in and look up all the things you have in common with your second connections. So say, for example, you went to the same school or you worked at the same companies. You could say, hey, look, we have all these things in common. It would be good to connect to see how we can support each other. And I would send out 300 requests each day based on just that concept. Wow. And what I found is that people like to connect with other people that has a lot in common. So I was able to grow my LinkedIn followers from 5,000 to over 10,000 on LinkedIn just using that concept.
That's significant. And I appreciate you sharing that specific concept and how you implemented it, how others can implement it too. Mm-hmm. Were you attracting the type of clients you wanted to work with through that strategy as well?
Absolutely. So just to give you an example, the kind of clients we have, you know, the head of global sales for PayPal is a client of ours. The Jamaican ambassador to the United States is a client of ours.
Wow.
Carla Hall, America's Top Chef in 2019, is a client of ours. She actually won the face of Tonal. She became the face of Tonal after her transformation.
Wow.
So we're talking about really sophisticated clients. I'm actually bringing bodybuilding light to senior executive women. So what does that look like? They do all their training at home. We ship Icon Meals to them. Shout out to Icon Meals. You
nice.
Can use my code Karene10 for 10% off. But we, you know, we have them living like bodybuilders. you know, they're just paying us to get access to what we have access to. So, and finding it in ways that is highly convenient for them.
I really love that outlook on that and bringing it to the professional space, because you'll hear a lot of people once they get through their professional careers or they're in that phase where they've accomplished a lot of their regret is that they haven't been taking care of their body, they haven't prioritized other areas of their life, and that's something you've been able to now show them how to do, it sounds like.
And, you know, it's also part of my experience too, because, you know, when I decided to pursue my health and fitness, my confidence, I mean, went through the roof after I did my first transformation. The way I showed up in the office, the way I walked in a room, the way I spoke to people, all shifted. It got noticed. And the next thing you know, I was asked to be the CEO of the Association for Women in Science. It's a 100,000 member organization that advocates for women in STEM. So when I saw what the physique transformation did for my career, I said, oh, good heavens, I need to help folks with their transformation. Because remember, I'm coming from investment banking where I study wealth, okay?
Yeah.
And after studying wealth in depth, I realized that true wealth is sitting with health, right? So if you improve your health, you can look better, improve your branding. If you improve your branding, you can command a higher salary, both whether you're working for someone or in business, right? If you improve your health, you can work consistently for much longer, which means that you can increase your net worth. So for many reasons, it's, you know, we say in the bodybuilding world, invest in yourself. We can invest in ourselves and get some serious return on investment by doing that. It's the best investment I've ever made. It's the best investment I've ever seen for my clients as well.
That's awesome, because you really have taken your own experiences and translated them into the professional space, as well as reflecting on your journey. You were living proof that what you had seen be true for people in terms of their health impacting their longevity and their finances. You took that, you applied it to yourself. You also then are now inspiring others with that and helping them apply it. I think it's an underrated part of life, and it's also something that is more controversial, I think, now, to actually make a statement like, if you look better and feel better, you'll earn more, you'll do better. It's controversial because we're living in a society right now that's like, you're fine as you are, you're perfect as you are, don't strive for more, just accept this. And I think that's a disservice to us. And you're nodding your head, so I feel like you have something to add to that.
I do. You can do your research. If you look at the Fortune 500 CEOs, not one of them is overweight. Just look it up. Not one of them is. I'm not saying that all CEOs are not overweight, but the Fortune 500 CEOs, the ones that are making real money, is not overweight. Just look at the numbers. There is, as a matter of fact, I'll take it a little bit further. If you look up the Bureau of Labor and Statistics, they had published a report of what someone makes if they're overweight versus somebody who is generally in shape, right? If you're overweight, you get paid a whole lot less than somebody that is
healthy weight,
exactly. Now, it happens in every race. It happens to Black folks, white folks, Indian folks, men, women. It happens to everyone. But if you are a minority and a woman, the gap is even wider. Okay, these are actual data that has been provided by the Bureau of Labor and Statistics. And it's that kind of data that caused me to even go into business to do health and fitness, because I realized that, you know, we talk about gender equity, right? That men get paid way more than women, the white folks get paid way more than the Black folks. We hear all of that. You could go to diversity and inclusion events, they will talk about it, but nobody talks about the weight aspect of it, because if anyone does, they can get sued for discrimination. So nobody wants to talk. It, as you said, it's a highly controversial topic. But if you do the research, or if you just open your eyes and see, I will even go a step further to say, there's a woman that came to work with us. I can't tell you her name, but she advised Cardalisa Rice, and you know, during while she was campaigning, right? And she was saying that even in politics, the folks that do well in politics have a certain look to them, right? Certain stature, certain height, even. Okay. John McCain, for example, when he didn't win the election, he was a good candidate, but he was on the shorter side. There's some discrimination when it comes on to weight, height, all these types of things, that's out there. Now, it's not fair. It is not fair in any way you look at it. But if you can control some aspect of it, right, at least give the information so somebody can put that into effect, right? We can't change the system, but if we work on both ends, right, to help the folks in the system while we work on the system itself, then we can burn the candle from two ends. So that's my thought about it. It's highly controversial, but that's the way I think about it.
Thank you for sharing your thoughts on it, because I think people are quick to think, oh, that's so surface level. Oh, that's silly. But in reality, there's so many benefits to pursuing this outside of just having a nice body, for example. And people forget to focus on those other benefits that it has, not just on your body and your physique, but also your family, the way you feel confident when you're going into a meeting, for example, or you're pitching something, you're promoting something, you're presenting something. When you're confident in yourself, it's like you've executed consistently on something, generally speaking. So you've mastered something or you've done really well. So you're confident in that. Similarly,
Exactly.
with fitness, you show up for yourself every day. Now that confidence radiates out.
I will tell you, I had a client who had a profile on LinkedIn, and the profile had her at one weight, okay, but her actual weight was a good 60 pounds higher, okay. So on LinkedIn, the folks would respond to her and communicate with her based on her LinkedIn profile. And then when they met with her, they would decide not to do the deal, right? It became a perpetual issue, okay? And that's when she came to me for help, right? So you had, especially entrepreneurs, where the entrepreneur themselves is a face of the business, right? It not only affects her as an individual, but the folks on her payroll, okay? So yes, it's, oh, we could go on and on about this topic, but I know there's some juicy things that we gotta talk about. But
Oh man.
yes.
Well, I'm not personally short on time. I'm loving this already, and I know others are. So, I had a question I wanted to ask you regarding wealth management, because you've worked in the financial field. You enjoy supporting others building their wealth in every area of life. What do you feel are some of the more underrated things people could be doing, but often overlook when it comes to business development or personal wealth management?
Creating a budget and sticking to the budget. And in bikini, for example, competing is very expensive. Last year, when I went pro, I probably spent $5,000 per competition. I probably spent about, and I competed three times, right? And that was a $15,000 to $20,000 investment when I competed in 2022. A lot of folks go into competing not realizing how expensive it can be. And remember, this $20,000 didn't even include the bikini suit, right? Because I had those before, and so creating a budget, but to create a budget, you have to understand the full cost, right? And I think that that is one thing I wish I had known when I first started competing. The actual, it's a very expensive sport, but not just to tell me it's an expensive sport. Like, give me the dollars and cents. Let's know what you're spending. If we were a little bit more transparent on what we're spending on competing, we can help younger competitors plan their finances a lot better.
I absolutely agree. One time I made a post like detailing some of the actual expenses, like money-wise, that went into it. That was from like a bare minimum perspective. But when you start competing at the national level, you could be spending over $1,000 just for the weekend, just to be there. So that's like for the hotel, and that's like a hotel off-site. That doesn't include your Ubers, your Lyfts. if you have friends and family, you're paying for their ticket to come and maybe watch the show. Or maybe it doesn't include like going and actually like
the
registering. Exactly.
So these national shows.
And how many classes you're doing.
Yeah, and I took all three classes. I was open, over 35, over 40. Every class I could get in, I went into it. So, yes, those things add up.
Yep.
You know, your tan, your makeup, your hair, you know, the suit, the heels, the jewelry, you know, it's a lot that goes into it, you know, that you have to really put a budget line by line and decide how much you're going to spend on each of them.
And then if you do and you spend all that money and you budget and then you don't also prioritize like practicing your posing, killing it in the gym, maximizing your efforts with nutrition, establishing a program and plan that's going to take you the long haul in this sport, not just a short bit and then you're binging and struggling post show, like you have to not just budget money and finances, but budget your energy, your investment of self and your commitment and how you want to be in this. At least from my mental point of view, I also think that's a very important piece.
So, you know, we didn't even talk about the expense of hiring a coach, hiring a trainer and all of that. And, you know, I was talking to a competitor recently and they were looking at comparing the rates of different coaches. You know, one coach might be $500 per month, one coach $250 per month. Who do you go with? And that kind of thing, right? Mm-hmm. My thought on that is go with a coach that has a proven track record of creating pro cards if that's what you want to do. Because if you go for a cheaper coach and pay $250, you're going to spend money on like five extra competitions that you didn't have to do, and you end up spending more money long term than yes. if you just went with a coach that had a proven track record. You might have to pay a little bit more, but if you went with a coach that have a proven track record to execute on what you want, whether it's getting a pro card or making it to the Olympia or, you know, doing well at the Olympia, whatever stage, you look for the coach that has a track record of success and pay whatever they're asking, right? It will turn out to be cheaper long term. That's my thought on it, especially when it comes on to money.
Absolutely. Well, I'm glad you shared that on the money side of things, because whether it's like competing or it's business or it's personal things, like we have to budget and stick to it, like you said. So that requires mindfulness and consideration. And I want to rewind to when you were in corporate America making the decision to leave. You were already really accomplished and you went on to continuously accomplish more amazing things. And then you look at your competing career too, and you've done so well for yourself. So has that go-getter mentality always been in you, or did you have to work to develop it?
Okay. Well, this, I got to tell you a story.
Okay.
It goes really deep.
I love it.
So when I was 7 years old, my parents separated. And as a seven-year-old, you know, I don't know what separation means. I did see my dad pack his bags and move.
Okay.
But in the back of my head, my parents are still married, and I'm going to throw them an anniversary party. And I'm going to go to all these different adults, and I'm like, you bring chicken, you bring rice and peas, you bring cake, you bring some drinks, some wine, some champagne. Now, all these adults did exactly what I asked them to do and showed up and gave my parents an anniversary party, and they are separated. Okay.
Oh my God.
They had to go through the whole feeding each other, giving each other champagne, that kind of thing. Long and short of the story, my parents got back together. Okay.
Oh.
And they had been married for 26 years until my mother died at 48. Okay.
Wow.
So I'm a believer that I can get anything I desire if I want it bad enough. At 8 years old, I wanted to see my parents together, and I made it happen because I wanted bad enough. Mm. And when I was getting ready to take the SATs to come to the United States, I told my parents, I want to go to America. And I want to have an American husband, an American house, an American dog with American children. And I'm going to learn to make lasagna because American children like lasagna.
Lasagna? How'd you learn about that?
TV. you know, when you're in Jamaica, you know, you're watching these things on TV, you make all these assumptions about what America is, that in my mind, that was America, okay?
Yes, that's so cute.
My parents are just like, we don't have the money to send you to school in America. I'm like, don't worry about that. I'm going to do so well in school that they will give me a scholarship and I'm going to go to America. And so they're like, okay, you know, but I was serious. So yeah. I asked my parents to send me to the SAT class. I made a perfect SAT math score that got me a scholarship to go to Howard University, where I studied engineering. And that is how I made to America. So that mentality, that was at 17 years old. So that mentality has been in me as a child, right?
Wow.
And I took that in studying at Howard, doing electrical engineering. I took that mentality getting to Columbia University, where I studied financial mathematics. And I had JP Morgan sponsor my green card and pay for my Columbia's education because I asked, right?
Yeah.
So that mentality has always been there since childhood.
That's awesome. You're such a power woman. Like, to be able to see that vision and execute on it from a young age with the story of your parents to also achieving the career success that you want, the educational success. And it sounds like they didn't have the money to do it themselves, of course, but you didn't feel limited in your mind and you wanted to pursue this. Was school something that came naturally to you, or did you study really hard to be able to pass and then get that scholarship?
Mm-hmm. My sister was way smarter than I was, so I had to work a little bit harder than her. She's a genius. Mm-hmm. But, you know, math is what came naturally to me, right? My English, however, was not the strongest. I had to work a little bit harder on it. As a matter of fact, I got a 500, I believe, on the verbal, and one university thought, how do you make a perfect math score and just score 500 on the verbal? She must not speak English, you know? And so I am just naturally gifted in math, and I'm average in other areas. When I was 5 years old, my kindergarten teacher told my mom, they didn't know I was listening, but I was listening. The kindergarten teacher told my mom that I was gifted in math. And I told myself at 5 years old, just stick to the math. It will take you through life. Right.
Wow.
And math has taken me through undergrad. I've been a mathematician for banks. And I apply math even in health and fitness. So I get DEXA scans, look at body fat, especially body fat in the abs. And I can run multiple regression on body fat in the abs to figure out by what month they'll see visible lines in their abs. So I've used math in, whether it's in engineering, finance, or in fitness, I apply math, and it has always paid the bills.
Wow. Well, you're talking to someone who was gifted in everything but math. So I'm like, multiple regression. Look that up later. That's really awesome, though, that you've taken something you're so gifted in and you've applied it in your life. I really believe, too, that we can develop our gifts further. We can utilize them. We can create new gifts. But a lot of us really, we have these innate abilities that if we foster them and we utilize them to our advantage, they can serve us really well. And you had set that goal. You made that goal a reality. You came to America. I have to ask you, was it all that you imagined? Does it line up with what you thought it was?
Gosh, first of all, I wasn't ready for the dorm life experience where you had to walk down the hall and share the shower with everybody on the floor. That was not on national TV when I was in Jamaica. I was just like, my house is better in Jamaica.
That's awesome.
So yes, I was a freshman. I was in the quad at Howard University. And yes, TV did not prepare me for that experience. But I was determined to work hard for that American dream. I didn't let it, you know, deter me, but I was really shocked. I was in for a rude awakening because, you know, just like Arnold Schwarzenegger, when you listen to his story, he was just like, I just want to come to America everything is so big and beautiful and da, 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 da. I was the same way, you know. So yes, I was yes, I was shocked, Celeste. I was shocked.
It's so funny because, like, I'll watch sometimes these shows and I'm like, you know, New York's not always like that. Like, it's a lot dirtier than that. Venice Beach, like, you gotta zoom in on these places because they be doing the zoom out picture of Southern California. And I'm like, I lived in SoCal. That's not how it is anymore. But okay, depending on where you're at. So I had to ask, I, of course, it's amazing. I wouldn't change, you know, my life. I'm very grateful for that. You obviously worked really, really hard to be here, which I imagine has given you perspective on things. How has, my mind's going in a few places, but how has coming from Jamaica influenced your outlook on success or work ethic, knowing you did have to work hard to get here?
So the part about coming to America I didn't tell you was that I'm a big daddy's girl. Okay, I look
Oh.
just like my daddy, and I was a big daddy's girl. And when I got that scholarship to go to Howard, my dad said no. She cannot go to the US at 17 years old. She's lived a sheltered life. She's just gonna go to America, get pregnant, and we're gonna have a teenage pregnancy on our hands. Okay. And
He
my
was watching different American shows at the time.
mom was just like, we gotta give her a shot, right? And my dad said, absolutely not. So my mom was studying pharmacy at the University in Jamaica, and she told her friends who are also fellow pharmacy students that here's it, that she has a daughter that just got a legacy scholarship to go to Howard. She needs to have money in the bank to show the US government that they can pay for my living expenses. So they all put money in this bank account so that I could get that F1 visa to get to the United States.
Wow.
When it comes on to success, I really believe that when women come together, they can go way further than if they are apart. I come to the United States on the backs of pharmacy college students that
Yeah.
pool their money to get me into the United States. So how do I think about success? So what does that look like? I have an event coming up on March 25th, right? It's called Dare to Be Great, where I bring together women in my community, okay? So I can teach them about health and fitness, but also to help women entrepreneurs market their business, okay? So we can keep the wealth within women-owned businesses, right? So whether it's the hairstylist or the massage therapist, or the person that does my waxing for competitions, you name it, they're all here. They get to market their business as well. And in essence, the women in my community gets to know all of my support system that helps,
Yeah.
because you have this beautiful life on Facebook and Instagram, but it's just like, look, I have a lot of help. Let me
Yeah.
introduce you to the entire staff, okay?
Oh.
And so what ends up happening is the clients and the women in my community, we all end up going to the same hair salon. We all end up getting with the same massage therapist. And now it becomes like a very close-knit community, right? Because we can keep the wealth within women and minority-owned businesses.
Have you ever been told that you can't heal your relationship with food unless you stop competing? Or do you feel like a lost cause because every time you've tried to heal your relationship with food, you're always met with the same challenges, judgment, shame, and guilt? But you're ready to get to that root of your relationship with food and really understand your habits and behaviors and make lasting changes that are going to drive you forward in your competition goals as well as your life? And of course, if you don't want to stop competing in this sport that you love, but you also don't want to continue down the rabbit hole that is setting you back in your life, emotions, and potential for success on stage, I want you to know that you can get through this. And no, you do not have to stop competing in order to do so. You truly deserve to have successful preps, productive improvement seasons, and peace of mind year-round. Because when your head is full of thoughts of food, eating, or guilt, you cannot invest that energy into the goals you truly care about. which is a big reason why I launched the 5-week food relationship program and why it has been my most highly demanded program to help competitors like yourself make peace with food so they can pursue the sport they love for the long run without having to worry about sacrificing their mental health. If you want to learn more about this program and hear from others who have done it, then visit www.celestial.fit/foodfreedom. Scroll through that page, get some information, and if you're inspired and you are ready to take action on this, go ahead and apply to work with me, and I will be getting back to you within 24 to 48 hours to go over your application and discuss your concerns specifically to determine if and how I can support you. Again, that is at www.celestial.fit/foodfreedom. That's such a powerful story, hearing you share that, especially about your mom going to her friends and then how this influenced your outlook on it and bringing women together. And you've done that. You've created a community to do that. You live it as well, which is so beautiful. And I couldn't
And Celeste, that's why I admire what you're doing, right? Because what you're doing is bringing women together to share experiences, and together we can do more than if we were apart, right? Yes. It's the same reason I listen to your podcast. It's the same reason why I decide to, you know, be the CEO of the Association for Women in Science, and now I'm the finance chair, and that's a voluntary work, and I do it gladly. Because I understand the power of when women come together, you know, and what you do, Celeste, is a huge reflection of that.
Thank you for saying that. Coming from you, that means a lot to me, for real, because that's what I've wanted to do, is just empower these women to have a platform for their voice. Because yes, we get highlighted for the physique or the bikini divisions growing because it's this desirable look, but like, let's look at and celebrate the women behind it. And we all really do uplift each other, and success leaves clues. So hearing your guys' stories is like, now other women can take it, as she said in the beginning, and that's what it's about. And then we foster community. Like, I had the podcast party, which was like amazing, and then when I meet these women in person who listen, it's like, oh my gosh, like, how am I here in this random place? Literally, like, someone told me that their nail lady was like, oh, I've heard you on Celeste's podcast, to one of the, to Hannah, who was at Cuties, actually. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. And I'm like, what the heck? So when I hear that, it's just like a reminder to keep going, because absolutely, we are empowering. Like, it's empowering. And me hearing your story, I'm like, oh, like, it makes me want to give more and continue to find ways to give more, because you were in a place where you maybe didn't know you were going to actually be able to see this dream come to life, but other women believed in you and they put you there. Now I have to come back to your dad, because you have a close relationship with him. How did he react when he found out, okay, this is really happening?
So, you know, listen, I don't know what my parents talked about behind closed doors, but my mom had a way of getting what she wanted as well. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So all I know was I was sent through the back door to go to the U.S. Embassy to get my F1 visa, and everything was presented on the bed when he came home from work. My F1 visa, my tickets, the airplane ticket was just sitting on the bed, like, yeah, dude, this is happening. I remember my dad said, look, you know, if she goes to America and gets pregnant, that's going to be on you.
That was his biggest concern. He's like, do not get pregnant.
Do not get pregnant. It's so funny. Now that I am like over 40, my dad is having this conversation. It looks something like this. You know, when your mom was your age, she had a 14-year-old and a 16-year-old. I'm like, Daddy, you have traumatized me ever since I was a little girl from getting pregnant. And now you wonder why I'm 40-something and don't have kids.
Do you want kids?
I do want kids. I do want kids. And my husband wants kids. So we're planning on competing this year, doing that reverse diet, and go straight into fertility treatment to have kids.
Oh, that's so exciting. And I'm gonna now rewind to what you said, which is your mom got what she wanted just as you do. And so let's talk about your husband because me and you chatted a little bit about this before I hit record and I gotta have this story shared and I wanted to ask you about it, but I didn't know all this. So you guys buckle up. This is a cool story and I think it really speaks to how Kareen's inspired herself and uplifted herself and really made sure not to settle in her life. So, just as you've gone after everything else you wanted, you made it very clear what you wanted from a man. So, tell us the story from the 22 years of dating to getting married at 40, and of course, the infamous spreadsheet.
Yes. I came to US at 18, dated for 22 years. When I was at Fannie Mae, I was approached by this gentleman that was 300 pounds. It was a lot of gentlemen to love. And he said that he was interested in me. And I was shocked because, I'm a black woman, he's a white man. And he, in my mind, and we've said so many controversial things on this topic.
At
So
this point, let it
at
go.
this point, it's just
They're
out
already out. If they disagree with the first part, they stop listening.
Celeste, you bring this out in me, but you just let me just come as I am. I feel
Oh.
so. This is what inclusion should look like. So I will tell you, my husband looks so white that I didn't think he had black friends. So when, I thought he was just, he would break my computer just to talk to me. I had no idea.
Oh,
I was super clueless.
wait,
Anyway,
you mean he would break your computer so he could come over and try to help you?
yes, call the help desk. Yes, and he's the first one to jump so he could have FaceTime with me, right?
That's cute.
So when it became clear that he was serious, I said, we dated for a while. And then actually, it was while we were dating that the doctors found a lump in my breast. He was in the doctor's office with me when I got the doctor's report that there was a lump in my breast. Now, he met me as this investment banker who had all these house parties and was doing all this high society, highfalutin things to this girl that decided to eat in Tupperware, right? Going into the gym all the time, right? So it was an adjustment for him. He was just like, who is this? Okay. So I had my first competition. He was always very supportive. But when I saw what it did for my career, as I said earlier, I decided I wanted to start a business. So I said, honey, I really want to start Fit Hidden Figure. And he said, I will support you. That's such a great idea. And I'm like, let's talk about what support really looks like. You're 300 pounds. Nobody's going to want to come to me for fitness if you're 300 pounds. So he goes, wait, are you saying that I have to lose body fat to be with you? I said, yes, that's what I am saying. He said, you're vain. I'm out of here. He packed his bags and he left. He was like, I'm big boned, lady. I've always been big boned. My mama was 500 pounds. My sister's 400 pounds. I've always been, everybody in my family's been big bone. That is you. That will never be me. Packed his bags to that. So the pandemic happened, and I started the business working on women, transforming women primarily. And then I transformed one gentleman who convinced me to do his transformation. He had a killer 16-week transformation. I posted it on Facebook. Chris saw the post on Facebook and was just like, she now transforming men? Oh, I gotta call her up. So he calls me up. And he goes, look, Kareen, we're in a pandemic. I have multiple sclerosis. Yeah, he suffers from multiple
Oh,
sclerosis.
wow.
And he said, I could die from MS if I were to get, yeah, I could die from COVID if I were to get COVID. And I said, yes, and I'm like, the obesity doesn't help either. And he goes, well, can you coach me? I'm like, coach you? I run a legitimate business. So for a proportion of your salary, we can work something out. So he paid me for his transformation. In 16 weeks, he had an incredible transformation. He went from 35% body fat to 15% body fat, right? And this is data from a DEXA scan that we're talking about. So when he got to 15% body fat, he goes, look, lady, I check all the boxes, so you put a ring on it. And
Now,
as I
wait, let's back up a little because they don't know about the Excel spreadsheet that led him to saying about checking the boxes. So break that one down really quick.
So when we were dating, when we first met, I told him that we would most likely not be a good match. He said, why? I said, well, according to my dating model, you won't score very well. So he goes, give me a try. Let me see what your model provides. He scored a 65% in my dating model. Now, this model had a list of everything I wanted in a man, and it was weighted according to a level of importance to me. Okay. And so he scored 65%. So he goes, can I take a look at your model? So I said, sure. He goes, well, I can't change this about myself, but I can work on this, 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 and this. Now, based on my calculation, Miss Mathematician, if I work on these things, I think I could score a good 85%. Would 85% work for you? I'm like, yes, it sure will. And so he worked on that 85%.
That's your passing score.
That was his passing score. And you know what's really interesting? Now that I've been married for, we got married on 2-2-2-2-2, and we just celebrated a year of marriage. And all the things that I thought I needed in a husband, it's just what I wanted. It's not what I needed. What I needed was someone that treats me so special, treats me like I would just walk on air, right? Give me the kind of love. I was telling Celeste before the call, like my parents love me. I came from a great family, but the love from my husband is some next level love that I've never experienced. And but God knew that that's what I needed. And so his heart and his love is my safe place. He's sweet, he's loving, and he's also very competitive too. And this
Clearly, if he was trying to get the 85% lock you down.
so here's a competitive part. In 2019, I was competing and I was visibly shaking on stage. Okay. And when you're just nervous and you're turning, your back turning, you're just shaking.
Oh, yeah.
I came off stage. It was my second competition ever. I came off stage and he goes, how do you expect to compete shaking like this? You gotta look confident on stage to win. Like, see, this is not you. Said it in front of my dad, my client. I was pissed. Less.
Of
I
course.
was like, ooh, if you have some feedback for me, you better tell me in private, okay? We've since worked on our relationship skills. But I was so pissed. Less. I went backstage early. I was just like, this dude, he over there, 300 pounds. Telling me that I'm shaking on stage. Does he know how hard it is to and get on stage, So in my anger, I went back on stage in finals, okay? And I crushed it. I end up winning the masses overall in that show.
That's
Okay.
awesome.
And I was not center stage when, like you kind of have an idea as to what how you do during pre-judging. I was not in the center of prejudging, right? They
Okay.
made the door routine again in finals, and I end up winning the masters overall there.
That's
So,
awesome.
my dad was in the audience. And I'm like, Daddy, was it really that bad in prejudging? He goes, yes, honey. When you came on the finals, you were a completely different athlete.
That's awesome.
So, that is point number one with Chris. No shaking on stage. Don't let us go through all this prep for you to shake on stage. That is not going to work. His second pet peeve when it comes on to competing is when I competed at North Americans in 2021, and that was my first national show. And I remember looking at everybody else was like, oh, everybody looks so good. Oh my gosh. I just felt happy to be there because I'm just like, for the first time, I'm in front of all these people and everybody looks amazing. So I'm not expecting to get first call outs or anything. I'm just happy to be there. So I compete and they call my number for first call outs at North Americans. I'm standing there off to the side, just posing, smiling. Right? Off stage, and my husband was just like, "You work so hard to make it to nationals, and they call your number, and you're looking shocked? You have the app."
That's so cute.
So don't shake on stage and act like you've been here before.
Yes, I love that. Hey, he gave good feedback.
Oh, really good feedback. It's so funny. He's gotten in, and then the big announcement is this. I don't know when this is going to come out, but my husband is going to be competing for the first time at DC Pro on June 10th.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome.
So here it is now. If he shakes on stage now, you all, it's on. I'm putting it up there.
He's gonna get exactly what he gave to you, basically.
They call his number and he looks shocked. It's gonna be a problem. So the tables have turned.
That's awesome. Well, this will come out in May, so if you guys are listening and want to wish him luck, you got a month to do that. So that's awesome. And I love the way that you stood up for what you wanted in the relationship. You also utilized your math skills to create this spreadsheet, which is just awesome. I'm sure maybe people will reach out to you like, "Hey, give me that spreadsheet. Give me those functions. I need to be able to do that." But what I really loved is how you said that was built on what you wanted, and then you came to learn a lot of what you needed. And you described this next level love, and really what you guys fostered and how you support each other as well, and the way he supports your brand, your business. He's a good representative, as are you, of course. And I think that in marriage and in competing and in this whole journey, things can get affected. So you obviously inspired him to get in shape. You obviously have inspired him to compete. He's been really supportive of that. What are some of the difficulties you guys have faced in your competing journey, especially as a newlywed or just in general, even while dating?
So this is a part I was not ready for. Okay, so we got married on 2/22/22, February 22nd, 2022, and I went pro July 22nd or July 23rd of 2022. So about 5 months after I got married was when I got the pro cards. I actually won two pro cards, first place in over 35, first place in over 40. Now, I have to give the timeline for you to understand why this is important. So, you know, when you get stage lean, I got as lean as 7.8% body fat lean. And
That's
this is
lean.
data based on DEXA scan results,
DEXA,
not
yeah.
me guessing body fat. When I got below about, say, 11, 12%, I had stopped seeing my period. And my desire for sex went away. Okay. And you know, for us, we waited until marriage to have sex. So here is it that we got married in February, and by about May, June, sex stopped. Okay. And stopped for a long time because, you know, when I went pro in July, you have to do the reverse diet for your body to put the body fat back on, for your period to come again, for you to get the sex drive again, that kind of thing. So I'm working through my reverse diet. And at this point, we were noticing that there were some struggles in the marriage, right? We love each other very much, but love alone, it's not just love alone. You know, you have to have everything has to be ticking, right? So we went back to the couple that married us, you know, and the couple said to us, "True story. Kareen, on a scale of 1 to 10, where do you see the marriage?" And I said, "I think we're at a 7." And Chris, on a scale of 1 to 10, where do you see the marriage? Chris said, "I think we're at a 6." Okay, let's peel back the layers and figure out what is going on. So they talk to us for a few minutes and they go, "Well, this marriage is at a 3." Okay. Now, it's funny that I am getting scored on my marriage in numbers, by the
Of
way.
course,
Okay.
naturally.
Because, you know, I'm all about the results and all about the numbers. So I'm like clenching my pearls. I'm like, three? Kareem? A three? You know,
Never in my life.
my life. How could be so? What's going on? So the wife, you know, the couple that's counseling us, the wife said to me, Kareem, you're depriving your husband of sex. Depriving your husband of sex is like depriving a newborn of breast milk. This is like, oh, she's like, men need sex and blah, blah, blah. No, she doesn't understand what it's like to be a competitor or anything like
Right.
that. Okay. All she knows is that for a healthy marriage, there got to be a sex life, frequent sex, and that kind of thing. So that was when I was just like, oh my gosh, my poor husband, I'm depriving him of breast milk. Oh my
He's like, I'll tell you exactly what to say to her. That'll get I'm just kidding.
traumatized. I have turned up the room, I turned up the temperature in the bedroom to the next level because I was like, I don't need nobody telling me I'm depriving my husband of breast milk. And so, we were able to work through that. But, you know, I gotta imagine that competitors struggle with that, with low libido, when you get lean, that kind of thing. And especially when it coincides when you first get married and all the implications of all of that, you know, I wasn't ready. I wasn't ready, y'all. I wasn't ready for that. But it was a good learning experience.
It's something that I think needs to be talked about more. So I was grateful that you put it in there that you would be willing to discuss it because it came up at Cuties and it was a big conversation piece, actually, like what women did, what some of the IFBB pros, even some well-known coaches, and that was not recorded, I don't believe. So I'm not going to get into all the details. I don't know if it was, but anyway, I think that that's an important conversation to have because, and it's an important one to have with your husband or your boyfriend or whatever it is that you're doing. So it's like, that's something that could change. It doesn't change for everyone, but it could change. And it's like, how do we deal with those when they come up? I think it's really cool that you guys went to the couple that married you. So, and it sounds like you guys have really established a marriage with God at the center based on going to a couple for that counseling. At least that's what it sounds like. Is that right?
Yes, and we've taken it to a step further. This couple that married us, there's a commitment. Like, I marry you, it's till death do you part, baby. This is how we are ride or die. We don't believe in divorce. Ain't happening. Ain't no nada nada. We gonna figure it out. So this is a commitment that we made to this accountability couple before we got married, right? So their job is to ensure the success of our marriage. But in addition to that, we also are part of a ministry called Couples in Discipleship, where we meet every Sunday at 11:30 in the morning, where we learn about skills that's needed in a marriage, right? Things like apology language, like how do you say sorry to someone? You know, the love language is a little bit more popular, and a lot of people know about the love languages, but I never heard about the apology language. So there is a way to say sorry to somebody so that they can literally feel that you're truly sorry. You know, there are some people require just feeling a feeling of regret. Some people require you know, actually what's the term? You know, like paying for, you know, doing something like, you know, like say if you do something wrong, you do something to make up for it, that kind of a thing. So there are different ways of saying, I'm sorry. And we learn skills like that, the importance of respect for a man and the importance of a
Oh my gosh, I'm literally doing a devotional with Sean right now called Love and Respect. It's a daily devotional, and it's all about women needing love, men needing respect.
girl, we have to read that book in our class. Okay.
Okay, that's so crazy that we're on this wavelength.
Yes, that thing is a real deal, right? And the training tears apart how well you're doing with respecting your husband and how well he's doing with loving his wife. And we even are also reading this book, great book, called Sacred Marriage. That's also part of the curriculum. So there's quite a few books that we have to read. It's a 10-month program.
Okay.
And we meet once a week for 10 months to ensure
That's
the success
awesome.
of our marriage.
I love that because we're just controversial today. I think it's great. Some people really do think you don't have to do much work. They'll say marriage takes work. I think a lot of people do the work when it's needed rather than proactive work and preemptive work. Now, I'm not married, so I'm not speaking from that perspective, but from like a dating and relational standpoint, and I was in a very long relationship prior to the one I'm in now, we didn't do a lot of that work. And I'm making sure that me and my current boyfriend, we are doing that work and we do daily devotionals and we're very committed to learning and being proactive. I think the work is enjoyable when it's proactive. It's difficult in the moment. There's always difficulties, but it's like, if you've done a lot of that proactive work and then you're willing to do that, I think it can make it better. So I think it's great you guys are prioritizing that. Yes, it's a 10-month commitment. It's a weekly commitment. It's something you're focusing on even daily between those weekly meetings. But it's clearly like helping you guys be on the same page or learn more about each other. And I think it creates a space to express needs that otherwise maybe wouldn't be created.
Oh, yes. That's a good point. There's so many things I can share. Let me start with one. Okay.
Yes.
So they made us do this exercise, okay, on what are three unmet expectations you've experienced in a marriage, right? So I had to write three unmet expectations. He had to write three unmet expectations, right? Then we switched the paper, okay, to see what these three, and you know me, I'm all about performance. I'm like, 1 year in the marriage and I can't even get to meet expectations in the marriage is hard work. So I saw this unmet expectations, and then at the end of it, they make us tear it up. See it and just tear it up. Okay. And this is one, it gave me a glimpse into what is not meeting Chris's expectation. One of his expectations was, I thought we would have had kids by now. Okay.
Wow. 1 year in.
Yeah, that was his expectations, yeah. Right? And so we tore it up, but now it's in the back of my mind that, you know, he's serious about this children thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so I just want to make sure I plan up my competitive journey to honor that. I mean, when we got married, we said we were going to have kids, you know, so how do we make sure? It's going to be really interesting because, you know, as I said, you know, lean out, you most likely may not see your period, go into reverse, see your period again. And literally shortly after that, we're going into fertility treatment. My husband did a vasectomy, so we have to go all the way fertility treatment to have children. So, you know, the science and the data is going to come in very, very handy to navigate that process.
Absolutely. Well, I think it's amazing what you guys are doing together, building together. There's obviously so much love and respect there and amazing, you know, cultivation of that from the beginning. And it's really beautiful. And I love how you express like what your plans are too, because I was hoping you could maybe dig into what you're wanting to get out of your bodybuilding career and how your experience at the IFBB level, specifically the Masters World Pro, maybe compared to your time in the NPC as well.
Man, these Masters Pro ladies, they are not playing around.
For
they
real.
Whoop your ass in a minute. Okay, let me just start there.
So do you though. Like, you have an amazing physique. I mean, I seen your stage photos. I'm like, holy.
You know, thank you so much. And, you know, I don't know if when you're a few years older, you're very conscious that you don't have a lot of time left. Mm-hmm. Okay. And your approach to bodybuilding is very, very different. Okay. It's a lot more, I don't know. It's intense. You know what I mean? When you're at this age, getting that level of leanness and competing, it's not easy. That's why they have masters over 35, over 40. It's difficult. But I have so much respect for these ladies. I competed in the Masters World Pro the day after I turned pro, and I placed. I got 13th place, and I'm grateful for my placing.
That's amazing.
And it was a group of, I want to say 25 or 30 girls that showed up for World's Masters Championship. So what I want to do is I'm applying for Masters Olympia in Romania.
Nice.
Yes. The application deadline is April 10th. So by the time this show comes out, the results will be out there in terms of who made it to Masters Olympia. Right.
Yes.
I'm working diligently in the gym so that I can put in a very convincing application on April 10th. The results will come out on April 25th. But that's my plans for competing.
What's required for that application?
A 1 minute video, information on your social media, your competition placings. And competition photos, I believe, something like that. The list of things that you have to produce.
Nice. Well, I'm excited for that. I can't wait, honestly, because I think it's going to be super cool. I'm glad that they're doing it. It's interesting that it'll be in Romania, but an adventure for sure. So do you already have your passport?
Well, I do have my passport, but guess what?
What?
The time I took my passport, a 30% body fat face is very different from an 8-9% body fat face. Okay.
It's true. You may not make it across. You may have to go retake the photo at least.
Retake the photo because my face looks completely different. Yeah, so before my fitness journey, my first DEXA scan was close to 30% body fat. So I was one of those skinny fat folks. And so, yes, I need to update the passport.
You know, it's funny because like I was just looking at different photos of my sister because I love her. And there was one of us in Pittsburgh when I went to North Americans this past year. And it was a selfie of us. And I was like, oh, who is that? I don't even like how I look because I looked like so emaciated, you know, I just looked so skinny and my face was like, I look like a different person. But you know, when you start pushing the higher body fat and your face starts getting, I'm like, I have a round face, but when I'm lean, it's still round, but I look like my teeth looked it. Everything looks so different, you know? So that's what that made me think of is like, yeah, the passport, it'd be hard to recognize. So I love your goals. That's awesome. I can't wait for that to happen and to find out and celebrate you. And either way, you've got this really great view on how you want to approach this year and then what you want next for your life. And you brought up specifically the timeline is different for a master's competitor, maybe someone who's older, and you're also looking to start a family and you've had this incredibly successful career. So is your goal to come back to competing after family, or are you kind of like, I'm going to be done after this?
So, you know, I don't know. I've been looking at like Angelica, for example, right? Mm-hmm. I was a big Angelica fan.
Me too.
And she has her two babies and she just looks so interested in motherhood. And I wonder if the same thing is going to have to be like in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, yes, I will compete. But you just never know how you'll feel as a mother once the baby is actually here. So I don't know, you know, I don't know what kind of mother I will end up being. That's one of the reasons why I want to take a shot at going to Masters Olympia, you know what I mean, before having kids. I don't want to regret, you know, not taking the shot, you know what I mean? And, you know, and that because, you know, sometimes I've seen mothers where when they decide to have kids and they're like, I wish I had gotten this in life or did this and that kind of thing. I don't want to put that kind of burden on children, you know what I mean? Knock out what I want to knock out and, you know, have no plans, you know, kids come out and when I look in their face, I'll decide if competing is in the works or not, you know, I'm that open.
Staying open. It's not definitive. It's based on how you feel and where things are at.
Exactly.
That's beautiful. I think that's the way we should be living anyways, honestly. Should isn't the right word, but that's how I like to live and choose to live. It's like not be overcommitted to timelines because I've been there and I find it just makes so much pressure, and pressure leads to less pragmatic decision making. And I don't think that's fair because obviously mindfulness leads to higher self-esteem and we need these things. So I actually,
So talking about decision making, I love
yeah.
type of words that you use. This is a new occurrence. If you notice behind me, I have a sign that says Vistage 65. Okay, so I was just appointed the coach for nine CEOs in Washington, D.C., okay, with businesses between $20 to $30 million in revenue. They break up CEOs based on revenue. And I'm their coach. Now, Vistage is an organization that coaches CEOs, and I've been coaching CEOs for 6 to 5 years, right? And the whole premise behind Vistage is to help CEOs make better decisions, okay? So just like how you the words you're saying, decision making, make better decisions, because when you're a CEO, it's like a tree, right? You have the leaves, the branches, you have the trunk of the tree, you have the root of the tree. If you lose a leaf or a branch, the tree won't die. Okay. But if the trunk or the root of the tree is compromised, the whole tree dies. So you break up your decision-making process in leaf or branch decisions or trunk and root decisions. Okay. So when it comes down to those key decisions, those trunk or root decisions, you have to make sure that you're doing a proper issue processing to get those decisions right, okay? Because it will have long-term effects on a company, on a person's life, and that kind of thing. So there's actually a skill to decision making, right? That will cause you to have a successful life or not. So I like the word that you use, decision making.
Well, let's expand on that a little bit more. What do you feel is important for making those decisions, and how does one even categorize if it's a leaf or a branch or something maybe deeper?
Okay, so the way you describe a leaf or tree decision is, will this decision matter 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20, 25 years from now? Will it matter? Okay. So I'll give you an example. If, say, you're running a large organization and somebody wants to know if they can expense an Uber cost, that's a tree decision. Spending $20 on an Uber is not going to be a huge impact to the business. So the CEO should delegate those decisions, okay, right? So that he is not filling his mind with leaf decisions, right? What are the implications long term, right? The other thing too is decision fatigue, right? If you're living, you should be the CEO of your life, okay? So automate as many things as possible, right? I automate my meal prep. It comes from Icon Meals, Korean 10 code, if you want 10% off. I automate my gym clothes, okay? Or have my rotation, so that I limit the number of decisions I make in a day, so that I can use my intellectual capital to my best and highest use. Okay. And so, understanding how to free up yourself so that you are always in a place where you're making good decisions at all times.
Beautiful. That was a really wonderful breakdown. And it's funny you said CEO of your life, because I literally wrote on my little nose right here, I put CEO of your life as part of the title I wanted to make this. So the fact that you said that, I'm like, what? That's amazing.
Yes, and I gotta tell you, if we have a few minutes, so remember I was telling you when I got this transformation, all of a sudden I got asked to be the CEO of the Association for Women in Science. So when I got this position, I was just like, look, I know I look confident and all, but I am clueless to be the CEO of this organization. So I went to the president and I said, look, this sister girl is going to need some coaching, yo, some coaching, especially when you come from health and fitness. you know the power of a coach in your life,
Yeah,
right? So
absolutely.
I took that mentality from bodybuilding into my CEO life. I'm just like, I'm going to need a coach, right? Never done it before. I ain't trying to make a whole bunch of mistakes. You know what I'm saying? So that's how I learned about Vistage. So Vistage was a company that coached me into being the CEO of AWIS. So I called this company. The interesting thing about Vistage is that they're predominantly a white organization, and they're doing a better job of getting more diversity, right? So I call up Vistage, and here comes Kareen. I want to be coached. So he goes, look, you know, I have several groups you can be in. You know, everybody wants you in their group because you're a diverse candidate. So he goes, they break up CEOs in accordance to their revenue, right? So the 10 to 20 million revenue companies have similar issues. 25 to 50 have similar issues.
Makes sense.
50 to 100 million have similar issues. So they group them according to that. So he goes, these are the different groups I have, right? But you have the option to be in any room you want, okay? So I said, I want to be in a $50 to $100 million group session.
Where was your, do you mind sharing where you were at the time?
Our organization was around $10 million in revenue.
You're like, get me up there.
I want to be, I'm just like, look, you want a piece of this? I want to be in a $50 to $100 million revenue. So I get into the room, and of course, there were 12 white men, but get this. They were all married for 25 years or more.
Wow.
Every last one of them. Okay.
Okay, I love that already, but keep going.
Every last one of them. So I'm about, I don't know, 37 or something like that, you know, and I'm taking in all the rules. Because remember, math is my thing. So I'm putting everybody in categories. They say in our statistics program, categorical data analysis, there's a word. So I'm like, you know, because part of Vistage, you have to share what's going on with your health. You have to share what's going on in your personal life. And then you have to share what's going on in your business. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's how check-ins go. You know, you go around the room and you do check-ins. So I sat there and listened to check-ins of these 12 men. Okay. Every single month for a few years. Okay. So I picked up trends. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So we're in this training and they teach us that to be a good CEO, you have to learn to delegate, to elevate, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, wow, I'm going to have to get serious about delegating. So I said, I'm doing my own laundry. I'm cooking my own food. Yeah, I can delegate those things. You know, I can't delegate strength training. I can't delegate cardio, but I can delegate all the things I do for competing. Okay. I can delegate who thinks about my prep, delegate to a coach. I can think who thinks about my posing, delegate to a coach, and just start delegating, okay? So I went on care.com, okay? And I went on care.com, like, I don't have kids, but I have a few things I need some help with, okay? Mm-hmm. Care.com is where you go to find a man, right? And this woman, her name was Gemma, and she came. And I gave her a list of things, you know, sort my vitamins, okay? You know,
yeah.
On top of her, she sort my vitamins out. She cooks my food. I showed her how to use a scale and do the meal prep and all that kind of stuff. So everything that I needed delegated. Mm-hmm. So I go back to the class a month later, and they're like, Kareen, what did you do to delegate? I said, I went on care.com, and I met Gemma, and I delegated these tasks. So all the men busted out laughing, and they said, so we learned to delegate, to elevate, and you decided to hire yourself a nanny? I'm like, yes, absolutely, because all of you have wives. I need a wife, too.
Yeah, okay. I love that.
You have that free labor for decades upon decades upon decades. At least I pay my wife. I need a wife just like you. Now, that meeting, okay, changed the whole course of that group, okay? Mm-hmm. Because for the first time, they realized that, oh my God, we are all married for 25, 30, 35, 40 years, and we're in the 50 to 100 million revenue That's the room. That's what the room looks like. Okay. So they're like, wow, our wives are dope.
Oh, I love that.
And so I took that experience and I said, you know, one day I'm going to have a husband and we're going to build an empire and we're going to make it to that $50 to $100 million revenue room. Okay. And so that's the CEO of your life. That's your
That is
topic.
So cool. Oh my gosh. I love that story. I love how you expanded on that. There's so many nuggets in there alone. Like even just the men being able to actually receive that and be like, yeah, if it wasn't for them. And it's also just interesting insight from a statistical standpoint, because there's even, I believe there's even some statistics that show when people have kids, they end up increasing their revenue. There's statistics that show like after a certain period of time of being married, people have increased their revenue. I mean, you're really committing to a partnership, literally. And so I just love that. I appreciate you sharing that story. And yeah, go ahead.
You know, the way the story ended was the when you have a group of CEO, you have what you call a vintage chair, right?
Okay.
So the chair is, you know, looking at the dynamics of the group, okay? And they're like, this girl, Karene, every time she learns a concept, she implements it right away in some very unique ways, but she gets the work done.
She
okay
does it.
but he decided to follow my journey both on Facebook and on LinkedIn for years. So he watched me develop a fitness business, and then he told Vistage that we need to have Karene as a Vistage chair.
Love
She's
that.
really good and she would make a really good chair. So we explored it, didn't work out. He had his review and he goes, seriously, you got to get Karene to be a Vistage chair. Okay. And so they reached out to me and they literally handed me this group of CEOs. Okay. Because I'm really good at learning CEO strategies, implementing them, and issue processing. To be a good bikini competitor, you have to be good at issue processing, because issues comes up. Okay. So you get really good at issue processing and helping CEOs process issues so they can make better decisions and back to wealth, improve the wealth of their organization.
Well, congratulations on that, and awesome to that man for vouching for you and continuously advocating to get you in there. This is a very lucky group because you're so intelligent and you have so much insight to share. I mean, I would love to continue discussing all things business because, like I said, you're very insightful, and I am grateful for the time you have spent with us, not just on business side of things, but relational, competing, everything. So can you give us your best advice for someone who's never competed before but wants to, and then your best advice for someone on their road to pro?
Okay. The best advice to someone who's never competed before is just do it. Rip off the band-aid and just do it. If it's for you, you're going to figure it out. If it's not for you, you're going to figure it out. I think that a lot of people overthink, am I big enough? Do I have enough muscle? You know, just do it. Just, you know, a lot of people follow the pros, and the local stages is not that intimidating. Just do it. That's what I would say to a new competitor. So going pro, I would say get a coach. If you really want to become a pro, get a coach that has a track record of turning out pro cards. My coach is with Fit Body Fusion, Jamie DeBernard, and I went with her because she has a track record of producing results, okay? Also, listen to your coach. And I, when I competed at Universe, I got second place in over 35 and over 40. And I know, like I know, like I know that if I had listened to everything Jamie had said, I would have gotten first place at Universe. Yeah. So get a coach and listen to your coach. Get a reputable coach that has a proven track record of success. And when you find that coach that works for you, listen to the coach and stick to the coach. Love you, Mama Bear. That
Aww.
Is my Body Fusion. love her. It's been a great team, and they're super supportive. And I'm nurtured. I really am, you know. at Fit Body Fusion. And I just wanted to shout out to Sean Couture cuties. We're wearing our cutie 2023 outfits. I'm a sponsored athlete. If you get your pro card wearing Sean's suit, you automatically get sponsored for life. So I never have to worry about my suit anymore. That's and that awesome. Kind of thing. So I'm super excited. So three advice. Get a good coach, prove your track record of success, listen to your coach, and get a Sean Couture cuties and take yourself being sponsored for the rest of your life. That's it.
I love that advice. And also, just piggybacking off of your comments here, Sean is a great example of someone who also uplifts other women. And I'm grateful she brought us together. And Jamie as well. I've had really great, I mean, she's been on the podcast. She listens to the podcast. She said such sweet things about this podcast. So I'm sure she's listening. Hi, Jamie, which is awesome. And she's so sweet. And she's definitely, like, I've seen her really support her athletes. And I'm glad that that's been your experience. So how can people follow this journey of yours and continuously connect with you and learn from you? Where can they find you?
So I'm on Instagram as Fit Hidden Figure. It's named after the movie Hidden Figures with a Black female mathematician. So if you forget, the movie Hidden Figure fits in front of it. I'm on Facebook at Fit Hidden Figure. I'm even on LinkedIn, Fit Hidden Figure. My personal page is Karene Richards. You can follow my personal and my business journey. And if you have a moment, check out our website, www.fithiddenfigure.com. If you want some ideas on how to build a website for your business, how you can incorporate stage photos into your business, things like that, you could get some really cool insight by looking at the website.
Yeah, your website is absolutely beautiful and it gives people an opportunity because we have some non-competitors who listen too. So if you guys are considering working with Karene after this, definitely check that out as well. And I'll put all of that in the show notes page while I'll have my assistant do it because I've outsourced things.
Delegate to elevate, baby. CEO.
It's true. It's true. So she will put all of that. You know how we do it. So she'll put all that in the show notes page. You guys, that's on celestial.fit/podcast. If you're listening right away, it's at the top of the page. If you're listening in the future, scroll down to the category section, which is alphabetized. You'll be able to find not just all the links to connect, but you're also going to get a full breakdown summary of the episode, a bulleted list of the topics we covered, and timestamps. So the best part is when you hear something really awesome, you can go back and listen again, or you can tell your teammates and your friends what to look out for when they listen. So thank you guys in advance for tuning in, tagging us as you listen, sharing your thoughts on the episode. It goes a long way for the podcast as well as for the athletes. It means a lot. And then, of course, if you feel inspired to leave a rating or a review, we appreciate that too. And all that being said, Karene, thank you so much for your time.
Oh, it was a pleasure to be here. It was a dream come true, Celeste.
Oh my gosh, it was such a pleasure for me, and I'm sure to all of our listeners too. So you guys out there listening, hope you have an amazing rest of your day, night, or morning, wherever you are in the world while you're listening to this episode. Just make it awesome.